Welcome back. We'll start with NCERT class 11th, the third chapter that talks about the reforms after 1991. Now, what was the reason why we required reforms after 1991? The story till 1991 we have already covered. Now, what suddenly happened during this period? There were three basic things that led to the balance of payment crisis and a kind of urgent need for India to open up its economic corridors. So, in 1991, you have the balance of payment crisis that undertook, and three factors were primarily responsible for it. First was a sudden rise in the price of the essential items or the essential goods. The second was the government was not able to repay the loans that it has taken from abroad. So all the borrowings that India had taken from abroad, India was not able to repay those back, and the foreign exchange reserve that India had could only last for 15 more days. So there was a kind of immediate need to understand or to bring about economic changes or economic reforms. Now, during this period, what happened was you had the expenditure that was definitely more than income, and when you have your expense which is more than what you earn, you fall into a deficit trap. And same happened with the India during that time. So India witnessed a deficit, and during this deficit, government had to borrow money from the various banks or the people or the international institutions, we can say, or the international financial institutions. Now suddenly what happened was this expenditure became very much greater than the revenue that the India was earning, and this low revenue was accompanied with higher rates of unemployment. So what happened in India was very high unemployment was registered, poverty was registered, and a very high rise in the population growth was registered during this period. All these three things further accentuated the low revenue that India was witnessing. And again, this revenue, since it was very, very less than the expenditures we were having during that time, the deficit trap was increasing and increasing. The burden on Indian economy was increasing at a faster pace. Now, what was the idea during that time? The idea was to liberalize the Indian economy. So there were three basic reforms that we talked about during that time. That was LPG, liberalization, privatization, and globalization. And all these three fall under the idea of NEP, that was the new economic policy released in 1991 during the VP Singh's government, P.V. Narasimha Rao's government, sorry, and the finance minister during that time was Mr. Manmohan Singh. Now, under the new economic policy that was released, there were again three propositions that were laid down. First was opening up the trade restrictions that India was having. So, trade restrictions should be removed. That was the first key idea. The second was remove the restrictions on the private sector. So let private sector flow in for the banking purposes, for the financial purposes, and other industries to be established. And the third key aspect under the new economic policy was decreasing the burden on the government. So three things, you can simply understand it in this way. Three things that led to the 1991 crisis, and three things that helped the Indian economy survive out of this economic crisis, and that was the basic idea laid under the new economic policy. So the new economic policy primarily talked about two measures. First was stabilization method, and the other was the structural method. As the name suggests, under stabilization method, what was our aim? Our aim was to stabilize the scenario. So the prices that were rising constantly should be stabilized or brought to a kind of stagnant platform. The next thing under the stabilization measure was to maintain a sufficient foreign exchange reserve. So these two were the key aspects that were taken under the stabilization method. When we move on to the structural method, we were talking about removing any kind of rigidities that exist into the Indian economy. So all the kind of barriers, the trade licensing, all those issues were finally gradually removed. So these were the kind of structural changes that were brought about in the Indian economy, and therefore we say new economic policy was basically based on two pillars. One was the stabilization method. The other was the structural reform or the structural measures. Now coming on to the three aspects, the LPG that we talk about, the liberalization, privatization and globalization. So under liberalization, the idea was to liberalize the Indian economy. So far, you had trade restrictions that were coming up. Banking was restricted only to the government sector. All this was slowly and gradually opened up for the private sector. So you had more foreign direct investment coming up with more than 50% stake in the banking sector. You have more and more inflow in terms of mutual funds, private sector banks, more industrial products were allowed into India. If we talk about specifically about the industrial sectors, you had the government undertaking that was there till now, and there was no permission to establish a new private firm into the market. Under this rule, under the liberalization, private sector was allowed to establish industries into India. All the goods till now were reserved exclusively for small scale industries. So from those reserved categories, some of the items were de-reserved from the small scale sector. So that was again a big push. All the kinds of industrial licensing that was there was gradually abolished except for hazardous items or alcohol, or explosives. All those items were there under industrial licensing. Besides that, other items were removed from the licensing list. Again, private sector was highly allowed into the industrial sector. If we talk about the financial reforms, you had the RBI, which was till now working as the regulator, was now becoming facilitator. So there were more private sector banks flowing in. There was more mutual funds, more international investments, foreign investments that were coming in. FII was coming in. So all those were the reforms under the financial sector. If we talk about taxation sector, corporate tax was reduced. Indirect tax was much more simplified. Further with GST, we have simplified it away lot. And then you have direct tax. So direct tax was made in an aspect that people don't do tax evasion. So ultimately the tax rates were reduced. So that was again one of the steps that was taken. And the reduction was mainly for people to help voluntary disclosure of the amount. Then you have the foreign exchange reforms. Under foreign exchange reforms, the rupee was devalued as an immediate action to solve the balance of payment crisis problem. Again, as a result, since the rupee was devalued, you had more foreign goods coming in. However, later on, you had an issue which talked about curbing the imports that are flowing in and making the domestic products survive into the market. So, inflow of foreign exchange was increased. And under the trade investment reforms, you had bringing in more competitive aspects, the foreign investments were increased and more efficiency was generated. Now, what are the ideas to protect the domestic industries, as we said? So, to protect the domestic industries, first of all, licensing rules were removed, export duties were removed, the tariff duties were reduced drastically, and all the quantitative restrictions on imports and exports were gradually reduced. So, those were some of the changes that were brought about under the aspects to protect the domestic industries in India. Coming on to the next aspect, that is privatization. As we said, liberalization, under liberalization, you had a major thrust or a major push on privatization. Under privatization, you had networks of private organizations coming up into the market, be it industry, be it banking or financial sector. And slowly and gradually, you had the concept of outsourcing that was started. And that was again very, very important with the aspect of the globalization that we would talk about. So under globalization, you had the internetworking of various aspects that took place. And ultimately, you had the products that were spread to and far within India and outside India. And as a result, you had outsourcing that became very, very important. Now, under outsourcing, what happened was, India definitely has a cheaper labor as compared to other nations. So you had more telecalling jobs coming up into India, more jobs related to IT sector coming into India because of this cheaper labor. And many of the industries which were established in foreign nations slowly and gradually started opening up their offices, the business processing outsourcing units into India. So that was again one of the major benefits of globalization that was witnessed. Under privatization, we also saw the aspect of disinvestment. So disinvestment, what does it mean? It basically means if the 100% share of a company lies with the government, what government would do is sell off an amount of share to another company or to the open it to the public. Now, until and unless it has 49% stake, or basically 51% stake, we would say. So it would be a kind of ratio of 49:51. So one which has 51% would have a majority say. So if the government has a 51% holding, still it would be a government holding with the maximum part that has been disinvested. The part that has been disinvested would provide more foreign direct investment into that company, and again it would improve the efficiency because this would now be maintained by people from private sector, where you could say the management or the organization would be much better as compared to the government sector, or much strict as compared to the government sector, leading to higher performance rate. So that was the aspect under disinvestment. Now we talk about three important aspects that have not been covered into detail in your NCERTs, but those are very, very important. We'll talk about the concept of Maharatna, Mini Ratna and Navratna. So Maharatna are the companies which have based on a 3-year average performance, have an average turnover of more than 25,000 crores, net profit of more than 5,000 crores and net worth of more than 15,000 crores. And they should be listed into one of the stock exchanges. So 7 Maharatna companies are there. So you have BHEL, you have the GAIL, Indian Oil Corporation, NTPC, ONGC and so on. Now what are Navratna? Navratna are the mini Ratna category industries which are having a consistently excellent or very good performance since the last 3 years. And above that, you have from these 6 parameters, you have a score of more than 60 out of 100. So the 6 parameters that were considered were net profit to net worth, the manpower cost to the total production cost, gross margins, gross profits, earning per share, and the intersectoral comparison. Based on these, you had numerous Navratna companies like HAL, Hindustan Aeronautical Limited, you have MTNL. Then under Mini Ratna, you have the companies which were showing profit for last 3 years with a positive net worth, and presently there are more than 71 Mini Ratna that exist, like IRCTC. You have the Airports Authority of India, BSNL and so on. Now under Mini Ratna, you have two categories, category 1 and 2. So category 1 talks about those companies which have made profit for last 3 years continuously, and that net profit is more than 30 crores. Under category 2, you have companies that have made profit for last 3 years with a positive net worth. So that is the key aspect under Maharatna, Mini Ratna and Navratna. The concept of these three is very, very important. Many of the students are stuck up here. So make sure you cover that completely. Now the next important topic that we would be touching is WTO or World Trade Organization. Now World Trade Organization is a body that has been a successor to GATT, that was General Agreements on Trade and Tariff. This GATT was established in 1948 with 23 nations, and the idea was to have a kind of multilateral trade agreements between the various nations. Later on, this body was converted into WTO in 1995, and under WTO you had a rule that was based on trade regimes throughout the nation, throughout the world. Now, most important say under WTO was for the developed nation. So there were lots of questions coming up why India is a member of WTO. Now, what would happen if you have a developed nation that files a complaint regarding agricultural subsidy? The developing nation feel that they are being cheated or they are forced to open up to the market. So all those issues are being touched out under this, and therefore India wants to be definitely a part of WTO and has been since long. Now, what are the reforms that have taken place during this period after 1991? So after 1991, we have witnessed that the agriculture and industry sector have declined. However, there has been a substantial growth in the service sector. So those are the three sectors we talk about, the primary, secondary and the tertiary. So the primary and secondary have declined, by the tertiary you have registered a significant growth. Now if you talk about the growth in the service sector, it's around 10%. You have high increase in the foreign direct investment and foreign exchange reserves that has seen, which have increased from 6 billion to nearly 321 billion. That's a huge jump for India. Again, you have the foreign investment. Now under foreign investment, what all do we include? We include the foreign direct investment and the foreign institutional investment. So foreign institutional investment itself has increased from 1000 million to 73 billion. So there has been a threefold or 1000 times jump in this amount also. So India is now one of the largest foreign exchange reserve holders in the world. Now what are the reforms that have taken place sector wise? So let's talk about the agricultural sector first. So under agricultural, we have witnessed various subsidies. We have talked about improvements in infrastructure, roads, power supply, the research related to agriculture, fertilizer subsidy. Under industrial reforms, we have talked about cheaper imports that are being now replaced by domestic goods. You have lack of access that has been given to the developed nations, and because of that, the tariff rates or the tariff barriers have been reduced. So this investment has been one of the aspects that has been working to promote the industrial sector. Now, one of the major tragedy that was witnessed during that period was the Sirisela tragedy. Under this, there were 50 workers who died in this region of Andhra Pradesh in Sirisela, and they committed suicide because there was the wages that were very low for the cloth production in Andhra Pradesh. Now again, with this low wages, you had power cut. Power cut led to further low wages because they were not able to weave the cloth, and finally you had more tariff that they were paying. So all these things together led to a huge burden onto the power loom weavers, and ultimately this was a big case that was registered. And finally, the idea was to focus more on the textile sector and see how and why there were numerous power looms that were closing up. So what are the basic takeaways from this lecture? The basic takeaway are, after 1991, we had the LPG reforms. LPG reforms opened up our economy. So we had more foreign investments coming up. We had a kind of liberalization for the private sector that was already existing. We were already expanding our markets, and this market-driven globalization has widened the disparities into the society. So that's one of the major drawbacks that we have witnessed. So the gap between the rich and the poor has further widened. Again, those who were at a higher strata or earning high incomes have again registered a huge rise in the income. However, those on the lower income strata have registered a decrease, or we could say have remained marginal on the rise in the income. Again, those who have registered higher income have also registered very high consumption patterns. So those were some of the things that globalization or the LPG reforms have brought to India. We'll be covering further chapters of NCERT economics in the upcoming lectures. So definitely stay tuned. Join us for more lectures. Have a very good day ahead.